Should we commence? Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to my talk. Just let me know if I'm too loud. I'm usually loud. So welcome to my talk on high performance image uploads, the web edition. A little bit of introduction about myself. I'm Abhinash. I am a UI engineer at Flipkart. I have been predominantly working on the Flipkart Lite PWA, and I recently moved on to the ads platform there. I am a gamer, a sneakerhead, and a biker. And you can find me at TwistedFork88 at Twitter. So let's jump right in. What's the problem at hand? So allow users to upload images while they were writing reviews for the purchase products. Okay, so the first version of Flipkart Lite that was launched, which allowed users to write reviews for the purchase products, that did not allow them to upload images as well. And the requirement that came to us was basically to implement this particular feature. And this talk is basically going to be my team's journey as to how we tackle this problem at scale. So let's first understand the requirements. We needed to validate the image before we upload. Sounds pretty simple. We need to handle the orientation because when we are uploading an image, we want to show a thumbnail. We want to handle something called an orientation, but we will look into it in detail. We need to resize the image before uploading. This is a standard feature provided by any file upload service, and nothing new is expected here. And finally, the insatiable demands of product and engineering that can you still try something better than this? Okay, so let's do this. We have the requirements. We are all the smart minds in this room. So let's try to brainstorm as to how could we potentially solve this problem, which might seem to be a simple problem initially at scale. So we'll go through the requirements one by one. So the first thing was we needed to validate the image. Sounds pretty simple. We take the image. We might check the extension, the mime type, the size, and based on our constraints, we either let this go or we bail out. Pretty simple. The next thing, however, is that we needed to handle orientation. So why orientation? Or why do we need to handle this? So when we upload a file or an image, we wanted to show the thumbnail for that image. So the requirement crops up from there. Okay, so before we understand how to handle orientation, let's understand like what orientation exactly are we talking about. So digital cameras, phone cameras these days, they have a lot of sensors and they can collect a lot of metadata about the camera or the device with which the photograph is clicked, and they can inject this metadata into the image. The metadata that we are most interested in is called the orientation property. Most of us here, we are already aware of two standard values for this property, for the orientation property, which is landscape and portrait. But technically, there are 8 possible values. You can think of it like the image is top, bottom, left, right, and the mirror of these 4 values. So that makes it 8 possible values. We are not interested in actually going through the details of all those 8 possible values, but the ones which actually impact us are the landscape and the orientation property. So to understand how this metadata is put into the image, how much of this metadata can be put into the image, where in the image can I potentially find this metadata, we have to understand a little bit about the standard that defines this metadata. And that standard is defined by something called as EXIF, which stands for Exchangeable Image File Format. I'll just read out the Wikipedia definition. So EXIF is a standard that specifies the formats for images, sound, and ancillary tags used by digital cameras, scanners, and other systems, handling image and sound files recorded by digital cameras. Okay, too much, but in a nutshell, what we want is we somehow need to get this information about the device and maybe things like location, and then somehow put it into the image file. This is what the standard defines. Now, this information could be things like your shutter speed, your ISO, your focal length, thumbnails even, as a matter of fact. For example, this is a standard picture. It is tilted purposefully. And on the right, you see a table listing out a few of these properties. For example, you have the make, the model, the orientation, we'll get into this, the ISO, the shutter speed, focal length, and all of that. So this is a subset of what can potentially be put into the image as the metadata or the EXIF data. Just to add, that EXIF data is only defined for JPEGs. We do not have such mechanisms for other file formats. Now, let's understand why are we even doing all of this? Like, why do we need to, now that we understand what orientation means, let's understand why do we need to handle orientation in the first place? To understand that, we have to get a bit deeper as to understand how cameras actually work. So there are three columns here, and the first column basically says, what did the camera look like when you clicked the photograph? The second column tells you, how did the camera save that image? And the third column tells you, when you viewed the saved image, what did it look like? Now let's focus on the second column here. It says that when you clicked the photograph, the camera was pointing upwards and the top of the image was pointing to the top of the camera. And this is exactly how the camera is going to save it. And this is exactly the same how you would view it, right? Now let's change the orientation of our camera. I tilted my camera. I clicked the photograph. But before saving the camera, the image, the camera is going to first ensure that the top of the camera is actually pointing upwards. So what we're going to do is actually it's going to rotate 90 degrees anti-clockwise and then save it. Now, if you want to view the image right away, you would actually see it in a tilted manner. But what is expected is that you should be viewing the photograph as it was when it was clicked, which means that somehow someone needs to tell you that this image has been rotated by 90 degrees counterclockwise. You need to rotate it by 90 degrees clockwise so that the orientation is set. Okay? And this is the reason why we had to handle orientation in the first place. Now, once we understood the problem, we thought about, well, do we have any existing solutions at hand? Does browser actually give us something? The answer is, unfortunately, yes. We have a very simple CSS property called image-orientation. And if you give the value of that property to be from-image, it would actually read this EXIF information and do all the heavy lifting for you. But as a picture speaks a thousand words, the not-so-humbling support for this particular feature made this information quite irrelevant for us. So we quickly realized that we have to take matter into our own hands and do all this heavy lifting for our users. So we had to extract this EXIF information somehow. So what we did was, we took this file that the user selected, and we read it asynchronously and as an array buffer. And thanks to the file reader API, by the way, file reader API is a dedicated web-based API for reading files. And it allows us to read files asynchronously and potentially as array buffers too. Once we have this array buffer, as we discussed, that first we need to find whether EXIF exists for this or not, potentially whether it's a JPEG or not. If it is a JPEG, but still does it have EXIF information or not? We have so many use cases, which means that we have to run a computationally intensive loop on this array buffer to find out if such use cases exist or not. And if they do, where do they exist? And depending upon the situations, we clearly very quickly understood that running all of this code on the main thread is not going to work. So this is just a sample code for how you're going to use a file reader API. You have a file reader constructor, you instantiate it. And at the bottom, you actually pass the file and call read as array buffer. And you have an onload handler, which gives you the array buffer in the result property. Okay, so let's now look at how this code executes when this EXIF extraction is run on the main thread. Okay, so I want you to focus on the fact that, let it run through one cycle actually. So we selected a few images here. Now you imagine when you click on add image, you see that the image is not responsive quite. It takes a lot of time for that bottom sheet to actually appear. It's taking a lot of time and it's intuitive, right? Because you're actually taking a big array buffer, running a loop on it, you're trying to find certain information, and it is blocking the main thread. Now, the most intuitive solution to counter this problem is somehow if I could delegate this heavy lifting off of the main thread, which is nothing to say, let's drop in a worker. So let's drop in a worker. You can see that if I now click the add image, it is quite responsive because you delegated this huge loop that you're running on the main thread to a worker thread. Everything remains same. You get the file, you read the array buffer, everything happens on the main thread, but the EXIF extraction runs on a parallel thread. But nothing comes for free. So when we took a call that we want to keep our main thread quite free for user gestures, maybe the application now has to pay a different cost because we added a new construct called web worker into our ecosystem. So what could these potential costs be? The first thing is that there is a creation cost of a worker. There's an instantiation cost that is involved when you ask the browser to create a worker thread, which could potentially spawn a thread behind and give it back to you. On a decently sized device, it is around 40 milliseconds. But this is not a really, really big problem. Why? Because technically, as a developer, I could build a worker pool where I could have a set of X workers so that I do not create workers again and again, but rather reuse them. So this potentially is a solvable problem to some extent. But let's discuss about the bigger problem. So imagine that you have two contexts or two threads. You have the main thread and you have a worker thread. They have to communicate with each other, correct? Like we created them for a reason and they have to communicate with each other. And this is what exactly the problem is, that there is a latency cost that is going to be involved the moment you start communicating between two threads. Okay, for the web developers here, what is the potential most ubiquitous way that two threads communicate with each other? Anyone? Message passing, of course. And the API would be postMessage. Perfect. Is there any other API? No, we want to talk about communicating between two threads. Broadcast channel is one particular API that you can potentially use for, you know, communicating between two contexts or two threads. But it makes sense when you have a lot of context and you want to broadcast. It has the word broadcast in it. We just had two contexts, worker and the main thread, so we just stuck with postMessage. Okay. Now the most common way that postMessage works is called the copying mechanism for communicating data. Which means that if you have two threads, T1 and T2, and T1 wants to send over some data to T2, then T1 first has to serialize the data. It has to deep clone this data using the structured clone algorithm, and then send it over to T2, where T2 will now deserialize and use it. Now it works very fine, but the problem is the deep copying step. Goes without saying that if your data that you're trying to send over is large, this deep clone is going to take a lot of time, which would mean that your post messages start lagging in, right? Now, given the status quo of web, do we have a solution? Can we get around this? Do we have something that will actually help us move away from this particular step and yet help us achieve our intent? And the answer is yes. That is implemented using something called as transferrables. So to understand transferrables, you can just think about that right now we were copying the data and sending over, right? In transferrables, instead of copying the data, what you would potentially do is you transfer the ownership of that data. Now imagine the data is the block in white and T1 and T2 want to communicate that data. Instead of copying this white block and sending over two contexts, you would shift the ownership of that memory block from T1 to T2, which means that once this transfer is complete, T1 will not have access to that memory block anymore, and only T2. This actually helped because you are getting rid of the entire copying mechanism and your post messages are going to be faster. And thanks to the fact that these transferrables actually is an interface and post message actually implements it, so there is no new API for making this work. If transferrables are supported in the browser, you can use it right away where you can pass the last argument as an array of these transferrable objects. So we realized that yes, if transferrables are available, this is the way to go. And we actually did a small experiment on a measly 1.7 to 2 MB sized image. And we ran an experiment 3 times and to measure how much does cloning takes for the post message and how much does transferrables take for the post message. And as you can see that transferrables actually gives much more promising results over cloning. And hence we realized that yes, if transferrables are supported, it's the way to go. So let's have a quick recap. What did we do till now? We made the user select an image.
We read the array buffer out of it. We created a worker. We asked the worker to compute the EXIF orientation property and give us back. And in the meantime, we use transferrables if supported so that this process is fast. And this is what exactly looks like after all of this heavy lifting is done. On the top, you see is what would have the image looked like if we did not do any of this. And at the bottom is the UI from Flipkart Lite, where at the end, Flipkart Lite actually understands the orientation and adjusts the orientation so that it looks in the correct orientation property. Okay, so the next problem was that we needed to resize our images before we want to upload it. So you can imagine that you have an image of W by H, and you want to resize to some other size of A by B, which is potentially smaller in size. So this is exactly what the exercise was, that you take the file, but you do not want to lose the quality over it. You are not reducing the pixel count in this particular image while the resize is going on. But you want to just reduce the size of the physical dimensions of the image. So this actually gave us quite a big bit of boost around the reduction in size, potentially around 30 to 35% in the reduction of the size just because of resizing. On top of that, we took it to the next level where we started experimenting with resampling. So resampling is like upsampling or downsampling, or where you can say that this is an interpolation process where, let's say we are discussing about downsampling. So what you would potentially do is you take a set of pixels and you replace that with a single pixel, which is an interpolation of all those pixels. Goes without saying that we have a loss of data and the fact that we are introducing noise to the system. And based on our knowledge about this domain and like we wanted to have a faster algorithm, which is going to give us smoother outputs, we decided to use the Hermite resampling for it. So the flow is pretty simple. We take the array buffer, we pass it to our algorithm, which resizes and resamples both, and then gives us back. From the array buffer, we want to create this image finally so that we can send it back to our servers. So we use the Canvas APIs for that, and we have two APIs called the data URL or the blob to extract the blob or the file out of it. And then the UI can use it. And this is what exactly looks like in the end, that on the left is the user uploaded, and the right is the one after resizing and resampling. You can see a little bit of damage around the eyes, the whiskers, and potentially around the leaves edges. Okay, so since the beginning, we have been discussing about the fact that this has to be truly multi-threaded, where the UI is doing nothing apart from the user gestures. But since the last few slides, we have been discussing about Canvas, our reliance on Canvas is too much. So do these two APIs can work in tandem? Can they work together? And the answer is yes, they can, with the introduction of something called as off-screen Canvas, where you can imagine that you had a DOM Canvas element, and you had the abilities of the Canvas like context, drawing, and everything. And off-screen Canvas just decouples them. Now you have the DOM element separate and the ability separate. Using that, you can now use these abilities on an object which is very similar to the DOM element. But it could work or run in a different context, like a worker thread or something. So something like this. So you have an off-screen Canvas constructor, and you could just call it and then run whatever operations you want to do. And this could offload all of your heavy operations from the main thread into a worker thread. Or you could have an actual DOM element in your UI and you could create an off-screen Canvas out of it using the transfer control to off-screen API, which can then run in a worker thread. But the beauty of this API is these two things are now linked. Any operation that you actually do on the off-screen Canvas object would actually relay those changes to the actual DOM element. So now let's imagine the resizing and resampling working on the main thread versus something using the off-screen Canvas. Now I want everyone to focus on the thumbnails here. When I selected a few images, you can see that when I'm selecting few more images, these thumbnails haven't actually come up yet because it is running a lot of code in the background because it is actually running the resizing of these files, but on the main thread. Now let's see how this looks like with an off-screen canvas. I selected those images. Now, let it run through one more cycle, please. Yeah, so let's select a few images. And now we select a few more images. You can see that the thumbnails have actually arrived much faster than the one which wasn't using the off-screen canvas. And it makes sense because it is running all of this code in a different worker context. So summing it up, this is what our architecture actually looks like right now, is that the user selects an image. After that, we extract the array buffer out of it. and then we pass it to a worker pool. If you remember, we talked about instantiation cost of workers, and to minimize that, we actually created a worker pool where this array buffer is sent, and for each image, we are actually spawning two workers, one to run the EXIF extraction and one to run the resizing. And the reason is these are concurrent, these are synchronous processes, these are loops, these are very heavy quadratic order n square loops, and they are not related to each other. So there was no reason for us to run them concurrently, but rather we chose to run them in parallel. And once the EXIF extraction is done, it would communicate to the thumbnail API, the thumbnail React component or the component that we have, that hey, I have this is the orientation, you can adjust itself. And when the resize is over, then it can communicate to the network utility that hey, I have resized this file, can you please go ahead and upload? So yeah, so this is it from my side. I actually have a little bit more slides around the a little bit of experimentation that we actually did around WebAssembly, where maybe we can just take a little bit of maybe a little two minutes more time. Where I would actually like to attribute this motivation to our native teams, where particularly my colleague Naresh. And when I actually spoke with him, he said that, you know, after all of this is done. By the way, this is exactly how the native flow actually also works parallelly. They say that, you know, after we do all of this sampling and all of that, we actually encode our final image into WebP to further reduce the footprint and then upload it. We had already converted a file upload into a research problem, then why not? Let's try if we can actually try this from web as well. But the problem is we don't have a native encoder or decoder API in JavaScript which is exposed by the browser. And hence, it was pretty clear that whatever we had to do it outside the realm of JavaScript. And that is exactly what the motivation of using WebAssembly came into picture. And no amount of time can do justice to explain what WebAssembly is, but I'm going to try my best in explaining this in one single slide, which has three steps. So you choose a low-level language, which is C or C++ or Rust for now, and you write your low-level code that you want to do. Then there is a set of build chain tools that you have to use to build and compile your low-level code that you have written. That build tool actually is going to spit out two files for you. One is a JavaScript file, and one is your actual module that is going to execute. And once you have this, this module is actually going to run in the same JavaScript runtime in the browser, which is actually executing your application code as well. It's very important to understand that WebAssembly did not push another runtime or a virtual machine into the browser. It actually relied on the existing virtual machine inside the browser, which right now only executed JavaScript, but now it is extended to run WASM or WebAssembly code as well. So yeah, so this is what our experimentation is. I think we are seeing good results, but I think our only potential call out is the fact that these JavaScript files and these module files are pretty large for now, and hence on a mobile network and on a low-end device, it has to be really, really, it has to provide a good ROI for the fact that you are making the user download a much bigger module. So I think in the new future, when WebAssembly improves upon the size of these modules, maybe it would actually help and bring in a lot of goodness that native JavaScript wasn't able to offer in the first place. So yeah, thank you. Thank you for your patient hearing. Any questions? Oh, okay, sure. Okay, we can have a discussion offline maybe. Okay.